So far in these videos, we've seen that twist is the number of complete turns one strand of DNA makes around the duplex axis. Usually the twist for a piece of DNA is the number of base pairs divided by 10. Right-handed twist is defined as positive. Underwinding a double helix either reduces the twist or creates supercoiling in the form of writhe. Interwound writhe is the number of times that the helix axes cross each other. Underwinding right-handed DNA gives rise to negative writhe, which happens to be right-handed in the interwound form, as shown. Now, to show how twist and writhe relate to each other, I will now introduce the concept of linking number. The linking number of a piece of DNA is simply the total number of times one DNA strand winds around the other. This includes both twist and writhe, and so L is just T plus W. Let's take a simple case of relaxed circular DNA. When we say DNA is relaxed, we mean that it has no writhe and there is no tension in its twist. So for relaxed DNA, writhe equals zero. So the linking number is equal to the twist, which we normally assume to be 10 base pairs per turn. So suppose this DNA contained 400 base pairs. The twist is therefore 400 divided by 10, or 40, and because writhe is 0, the linking number also equals 40. Now, here's an important point. For a closed circular double helix, L is always the same unless at least one strand is broken. This is actually true for any piece of DNA with fixed ends, or ends that can't rotate relative to each other. For circular DNA, there are no ends to be rotated, but you can also imagine a very long double helix where the ends are not free to rotate, either because they are bound by proteins or simply because of the friction of trying to rotate such a long piece of DNA. As an analogy, you can think of a long hose that a firefighter might use. If you pick up the hose in the middle and try to twist it around, your twisting will not be transmitted to the ends of the hose because it's heavy and there is friction with the ground. In the same way, a long piece of DNA is not necessarily completely free to rotate. But the point is that unless you break one of the strands, linking number doesn't change if the ends can't freely rotate, which can be true for linear DNA, but is certainly true for circular DNA. Now, there are enzymes called topoisomerases that make transient breaks in the backbone of DNA to control supercoiling. I'll talk about them in the next video. But in this lower diagram, this enzyme DNA gyrase has somehow nicked the backbone of the circular DNA, twisted it a few times, and then sealed it back up again. You can't do this without an enzyme. Now, if you look at the DNA, you can see that interwound writhe has been introduced, and this writhe is right-handed. If you remember the rule, you know that right-handed interwound writhe is negative, and you can see that the helix crosses itself four times, so W equals minus 4. We know there are 400 base pairs, and we assume that the DNA will adopt its most energetically favorable form and have a twist of 10 base pairs per turn. Note that DNA would rather make the supercoils than deviate from 10 base pairs per turn. So T is 40, and because W is minus 4, the linking number is 36. So the final definition I want to give is superhelical density, or sigma. This is the amount of supercoiling relative to the length of DNA. So you can imagine that you have two pieces of DNA and both have a writhe of minus 4. These DNAs are going to behave differently if one has 400 base pairs and the other one has like 40,000 base pairs. The one is much more supercoiled than the other relative to its length. And sigma provides a way to quantify this difference. So the definition is given here, and mathematically it's a fraction. This thing L sub 0 is on the bottom of the fraction. That's what the L would be if the DNA were relaxed. So for each of these pieces of DNA on the right, L sub 0 equals 40. On the top of the fraction, here is the actual linking number minus the L sub 0. The actual linking number minus the relaxed linking number, which represents how far from relaxed the piece of DNA actually is. So for this supercoiled DNA on the bottom here, L minus L sub 0 is 36 minus 4, 40, 36 minus 40, which is just minus 4, which is actually just the writhe. So you get a superhelical density for this bottom one of minus 4 divided by 40, or minus 0.1. So again, if we assume a twist of 10 base pairs per turn, sigma just turns out to be the number of supercoils per bDNA repeat. So in this case, for every complete turn of the double helix, we have 0.1 negative supercoils, or one negative supercoil for every 10 turns of the double helix. DNA in living bacteria tends to have a superhelical density of around minus 0.06 or so, approximately, minus 0.06. DNA is generally negatively supercoiled in vivo. We'll see why when we talk about replication. So as we've seen already, T and W are related in that they can be interconverted one to the other. Any change in linking number equals the change in the twist plus the change in the writhe. Usually, delta T is going to be zero, because after any change that's made, the twist will go back to 10 base pairs per turn, if at all possible. So any tension in the DNA structure is usually expressed as writhe. So this diagram is designed to try to show how the twist and writhe are related to each other. You can take this piece of DNA on the left here and introduce supercoiling in one of two ways. Along the top, you can unwind one turn, and so underwind it, and then join the ends together to make the circle. The DNA is less tightly wound than is energetically favorable right here. The twist will want to return to 10 base pairs per turn, or T equals 10, but because the L equals 9 and it can't change without breaking the strands, a supercoil will spontaneously form and you get a writhe of minus 1 as shown down here. And the other way you can supercoil this DNA is just to make a loop in the DNA like this. You're not messing around with a twist here, you're actually introducing a writhe, and then you close the circle along the top and you end up with the same structure on the right with a writhe of minus 1 and a twist of 10 and a linking number of 9. Now, if you look at the supercoiled structure, it's actually spiral writhe, and it is left-handed. You can see that if you point the thumb of your left hand right at you, and then follow the DNA as it comes towards you around this loop, and you'll see that it's going in the same direction as your fingers are pointing on your left hand. You can imagine trying to convert the structure to interwound writhe by taking the top part of this loop, so take this point of the DNA right here, and fold it down such that it comes below in sort of a figure-eight structure. If you do that, you get a structure that looks like this, and this piece of DNA that comes across from right to left is going to actually end up in front of the other piece that goes around the back. And you're going to get right-handed interwound writhe as shown. You can try to picture that. If you can't see it, I'm sorry, that's my best attempt to show why left-handed spiral writhe is equivalent to right-handed interwound writhe. Okay, now we've covered what you need to know about supercoiling. In the next video, I'm going to talk about topoisomerases, which are the enzymes that regulate supercoiling in cells.